October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, and while we see an abundance of 5Ks and pink bracelets to honor survivors, cancer patients continue to face rising healthcare costs and cuts to drugs and services. Ted Okon is the executive director of the Community Oncology Alliance, and he joins us now with the latest on cancer care. Ted Okon, welcome back to the Michael Eric Dyson Show.
Dr. Dyson, it's a pleasure to be back and talking with you.
Well, it's always good to have you here, Brother Okon. So what kind of cuts are we seeing to cancer drugs that really have, you know, a huge impact upon the delivery of health care to those who are afflicted with cancer?
Well, unfortunately, back in late 2003, Congress changed the way that it paid for cancer drugs. And that's had a profound effect because subsequent to that, there have been a number of cuts to payments to providers that are now really seriously impacting patients. Not only are we seeing a consolidation or practices that are closing, we're seeing a consolidation in cancer facilities. To give you an example, 199 practices, cancer facilities have closed in the last 3.5 years, but now we're seeing a national crisis in terms of drug shortages. Mm. So we are actually seeing, I saw a telecast the other day that had a father on talking about his son who couldn't get the cancer drug, his treatment had to be stopped, and the son passed away. Mm. So we're seeing more and more stories on the local news, national news, about drug shortages, and particularly cancer drug shortages, and unfortunately, all tied back to this payment that declines. It started in 2003, 2004.
Mm. Well, not only that, and that's a horrible story and tragic, and it illustrates the crisis we're in now vis-a-vis drug shortages. What about the surge in healthcare costs? That must have a deleterious and destructive impact on cancer patients as well.
Well, you know, there's good news and bad news when you talk about cancer. And the good news is we've turned it from virtually a death sentence to basically more of a chronic disease. The problem is it's come with a cost. The drugs are more expensive. The treatment becomes more expensive. And as a result of that, we're sort of going through this societal question and issue is even thinking about what is 4 more months of life worth, or 5 months of life, or a year of life. And so it's a good news and bad news proposition that we're struggling with. But what we don't want to have happen, we don't want to start rationing cancer care. We don't want to have more of a have and have not situation that we have now. And that's something that we've got to really deal with.
My guest is Ted Okon. If you're just joining us, this is the Michael Eric Dyson Show. He is the executive director of the Community Oncology Alliance. You've been communicating with elected officials in Congress to stop the cuts. So has there been an open arm reception for you, or are you getting a bit of deflection and stiff arming there?
No, we're actually getting more receptivity because members of Congress on both sides of the aisle, in both chambers, the Senate and the House, realize that there are problems. And now they're seeing in their districts and their states that there are problems associated with drug shortages. The problem is, as we speak, as we're talking right now, the super committee. So this is the committee that came out of all the debt wars. 12 members of Congress, 6 on the House, 6 in the Senate, divided equally between Democrats and Republicans, are meeting. And there's a list floating around of about $500 billion in possible Medicare cuts. And on that list is a cut that would be only $3 billion. Sounds like a lot, but it's not when you consider that they have to find $1.5 trillion in cuts, but it would actually cut cancer drugs even more. And we are petrified of that. So as I just came from the Hill and I was up talking to members and we're trying to open the eyes of the super committee, and there's a lot of receptivity there, that you can't cut cancer care any further. It's sitting on a cliff and we could push it over.
Yeah. Well, in light of that, you know, in light of the fact that it's teetering on the edge there, that there is what happens in the worst case scenario. If those further cuts are made, Does this mean that millions more of people are affected by that who now have cancer?
Well, there are over 10 million people in this country every year that are in some form of active treatment. There are about 1.5 newly diagnosed cases of cancer. And if there are more cuts, we will run into a situation, especially if we see shortages. And by the way, the shortages of these drugs are critical, essential drugs. The interesting thing is they are low-cost generic drugs. So we want more of those low-cost but critical effective drugs being used. And the problem is if we see more cuts, more patients are going to be impacted. And I'm afraid we're going to see more rationing. We're going to see more have or have not type of situations. And it's very scary. And let me just add that I come at it from a policy side up here. But I hear it every night. I'm an empty nester right now. Mm-hmm. And my wife works full-time as an oncology nurse. Mm-hmm. And she comes in every night with another story, you know, sort of mass patient story about where a patient can't get a drug or this is situation and a problem. So we have sort of this dinner conversation revolves around cancer, both not just from the policy perspective, but how this really is impacting individual patients.
Sure, and I'm sure that makes a big difference to you in your side of the divide. So tell us about the nonprofit drug company founded by oncologists. Is that an idea that really have an effect that's positive?
Well, you would like to think that we could do that, but I think in this country, it always runs off of the economic profit side. And I haven't seen a situation of creating, although it sounds great on paper, to create a nonprofit company to manufacture these drugs. I think if we don't do it through the normal system and channels and basically make sure that these manufacturers are incented in the proper way, and I'm not speaking for manufacturers, I'm talking for cancer patients. But I think unless we do that and we make sure on the provider side, we stop this, excuse the expression, bleeding on the provider side, we've got big problems. So I would like to think that would work, but, you know, I don't know.
Yeah. Finally, October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. So what should we keep in mind about breast cancer care and how should we add our voices and our contributions to defeating this disease?
Good point. There's a lot of emphasis on the cure. We watch the NFL each week, and there's a splash of pink, and it's great. Mm. But I would like to, the message to people out there is the cure is vital, and it's important. I don't want to take anything away from it, but think care as well as the cure. If we don't think about the care and the issues of breast cancer patients getting cared for right now, as opposed to the cure for generations down the road, the problem is the two aren't going to meet. So I would like to emphasize care as much as cure right now.
And by emphasizing care, that means that we preserve the lives of those who are already afflicted and we figure out ways to both give them quality of life and also relief from their suffering.
That's right. And in the United States of America, where we have decidedly the best cancer care in the world, we want to keep it that way. We don't want to destroy it. And we want to make sure that every American, regardless of any economic circumstances or anything else, can get quality, effective cancer care. We do not want to have a system of creating a system of have or have nots, and that is the scary part of this.
All right. Ted Okon is the Executive Director of the Community Oncology Alliance. Mr. Okon, as usual, thank you so much for your time.
Dr. Dyson, thank you.